Hello and welcome to Talking Books. I'm Jill de Villiers. Stress is a part of our daily lives. Sometimes we can feel the adrenaline coursing through our bodies, and although it's not a situation of fight or flight, we use it to overcome and successfully deal with a challenge ahead of us. At other times, it feels as if stress upon stress drags us down and as if we will never be able to emerge from it. My guest has done thorough research on the topic and has written an enlightening book, The Stress Code, From Surviving to Thriving. He is Richard Sutton, a health and performance educator and consultant. He has advised top athletes, Olympic teams, and international sporting federations. Welcome, Richard. Thanks so much for coming in and chatting to us about your book.
Thanks for having me.
Let's start with good stress versus bad stress. When we think about stress, we usually think it's bad, but it can actually be really good for us.
Absolutely. Stress actually, in the short term, is energizing. It gives us superpowers. We have improved vision. We have improved concentration, more blood and glucose to the brain and heart and lungs. We become energized. Our immune system is strengthened. And this energizing of the system is there to help us cope with the demands that are placed on us, help us adapt, help us change to help us overcome very challenging environments.
And then what is released then? That is the adrenaline that you're talking about.
So stress is about two waves fundamentally. Mm-hmm. So what we have is the first wave, which is adrenal. Mm-hmm. So what we have, we perceive a situation to be challenging, and all of a sudden our adrenaline kicks in and we feel clear and we feel enlightened, we feel energized, we feel strong. What happens, unfortunately, is adrenaline is very taxing on the body. So it can only sustain us in that state for a certain period of time before it becomes exhausting. And then what happens is, from a biological standpoint, we switch to cortisol. So cortisol is like our second part of the stress axis, and that is more sustainable. It calms down some of the responses evoked by the adrenaline, and it's more of a long-term response to stresses and challenges that we're confronted with.
Now, if we have the cortisol release in us for too long a time, the effects can be quite negative.
Absolutely. So both adrenaline and cortisol are associated with positive effects. So the positive effects of adrenaline are improved clarity and improved immune system function and so on. Cortisol's effects are immune regulating. So it actually controls the immune system so that it doesn't get out of check and we don't get too inflamed from the response itself. The problem with cortisol is that if it's in our system for extended periods of time, there are negative metabolic effects. So we can suffer with our weight or battle with our weight and battle with insulin sensitivity and the likes. But the biggest and most detrimental effect of cortisol is actually that on the brain. So cortisol, the research has found that cortisol over protracted periods of time has the potential to shrink the brain. So we have reduced brain mass or brain volume, and that manifests in reduced cognitive efficiencies and effectiveness. We also know that cortisol can change the composition of the brain. So now what we're seeing is different cells in the wrong places, so to speak, within the brain. Increased white matter, reduced gray matter, so computing speed is compromised to a certain degree. We also know that cortisol disconnects the brain. So all regions of the brain should be connected in this beautiful, almost choreography of interaction. And what happens with cortisol is it disconnects the intellectual centers of the brain or cognitive centers of the brain from the emotional centers, which can manifest in a hyper-emotional response. So these are some of the issues with cortisol, but principally it's going to leave us in a state of fearfulness, distracted, confused, unmotivated, self-doubt, lack of self-worth. That's a state that cortisol can leave us with over a protracted period of time.
Now, for people who want to know more, your book goes into greater depth as to how this happens and how it affects and studies that have been done. Tell me just a little bit about those studies that you...
So there's been extensive research. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the big pioneering studies was a Yale study looking at compositional changes with regards to the effects of cortisol on the brain. But saying this is the book does go into what happens from a biological standpoint, but most importantly, the book is about what can you do about it. And that's really what I want to stress, is the book is about solutions. If you have raised cortisol over a long period of time, what do you do here and now, and how do you reduce it so that it's not a compromising
I must say, for the first element. Chapter or two, I felt quite depressed going through it because it tells you all the bad things. Chapter two is also about some bad things, so I want to go into that before we go into the good things that about this. So chapter two is about the workplace, stress in the workplace. And what I find very interesting is we assume, we all think think that the stresses are for the people in high positions in the office. And it is not actually that. It is turned on its
exactly, head. Exactly. So it was a very interesting series of studies. There were two studies. They were referred to as the Whitehall study. So they looked at the British civil service and they looked at whether stress causes ill health. First time in history they were able to prove that after 70 years of research. And they looked at different elements of stress on health outcomes and the organization itself, who's the most stressed within the organization. And what they found in the first study, which involved over 18,000 individuals, over a 10-year period of time, was that the individuals within the lower echelons of the organization had high levels of stress and worse health outcomes over that 10-year period, to such an extent that if they compared the person at the top to the person at the bottom, their likelihood, the person at the bottom that is, of premature mortality, dying sooner than they should, is 300% higher than the person at the top. So that's quite significant. But the first study wasn't able to identify why. Why is it that stress in the work environment is affecting the lower echelons of the organization? The guys on the ground are the guys that are getting hit hardest in terms of stress. It's almost counterintuitive. The person at the top should be affected more by stress. They've got more responsibility, they're older, they're more seniority, more on their shoulders and more weight, but it wasn't the case. So what they did, you know, if there's a big question like that, what do? You put together another study. So the second study involved a slightly smaller group, around 10,000 individuals. And again, it tightened up the parameters. It looked at could they prove that stress results in poor health outcomes? And yes, confirmation there. But they also identified what was the difference between individuals at the bottom of the organization versus at the top, and why were their was their health profile significantly worse and their stress considerably higher. And they identified four elements within the study, four things in the work environment that actually cause us stress. Uh-huh. So the first is lack of control. So when we feel in our lives that we don't have control, we have no authority over our decisions, we've got no latitude over our decisions, that is when we become stressed and that is when our health becomes jeopardized. So much so that if you're in a work environment where you have no decision latitude, you have no say, you're being micromanaged to the hilt, the likelihood of premature mortality is around 44% wow. higher than those who are not in those environments. Sure. So that's quite significant. Yeah. It's actually safer to be unemployed than in that environment. Yeah. I think the prevalence of premature mortality with unemployment is about 40%, yeah. 38%.
Yeah. So just very quickly, the other three factors?
So the other three factors was effort-reward imbalance. Mm-hmm. It's about being appreciated in mm-hmm. the work environment. It's about career prospects going mm-hmm. forward, which is really important. And it's about proper compensation. If those elements were lacking, that causes stress. And we see that much more in the lower echelons of the organization. We also found, or the study also mm-hmm. found, that low social support within an organization is a big trigger in stress, where there's no support in that environment, where you feel isolated on your own, there's no mutual support between colleagues, major trigger in stress. And we see that often organizations put people up against each other to bring the best out of them, but it's almost counterintuitive. It causes a lot of stress and ill health and actually ends up being getting the opposite of the desired result. The last thing which was very interesting about the study is it found that low organizational justice. So organizations where there's inconsistent behavior from management, inconsistent behavior from the executive teams, decisions are very erratic, the people on the ground are feeling there's no justice, there's no fairness, major cause of stress. In fact, just to give you a stat, there's a 55% higher likelihood of developing a chronic disease in response to that environment. Hmm. Very interesting.
Now we get to athletes. You work yes. very closely with athletes and really high performance athletes. What we think is they actually they're exposed to a lot of stresses. It's a very demanding world that they live in, and yet they cope better.
Absolutely, and that's part of, you know, this. The book is basically a fusion between the science and my personal experience within the sporting world. I've worked with a winning Olympic team, two of our national teams, seven tennis players, been number one in the world, and they have a remarkable ability to withstand the pressures of the world and not only thrive, but their health is considerably better than the man on the street. There was a study looking at the longevity and health profiles of athletes, and what they found was the average athlete will live around 6-7 years longer than those in the general population, has lower rates of cardiovascular disease and cancer, yet they're exposed to stresses and strains from the age of 6 or 7, where there's this constant relentless pressure. And what athletes do well is it's a process. They integrate certain components in their life very effectively that either mitigate the effects of stress or capitalize on the effects of stress or nullify the adverse effects of stress in the long term. And what they do is the first thing that they take to heart is the reframing process. So whenever there's a challenge they're confronted with, they see it as a positive life experience. They see it as an opportunity to excel, opportunity to thrive. They're able to harness stress the way we should as an advantage in a competitive situation. The second thing which is very interesting about athletes is they have the strong connectivity. When they feel that they're compromised, when they feel that they haven't had a good time, when on the court or on the field, when they feel that their career is not going in the direction that they want, they reach out. Whether they reach out to psychologists, they reach out to friends, family members, other members of their team, the support members of their team, and they really create this connectivity. And by doing so, they further buff the adverse effects of stress, because in the book, I explain that there's a hormone that's released in response to connection with people. It's called oxytocin. And it's the anti-venom for cortisol. It's the anti-venom for adrenaline. So if you want to protect yourself from stress, it's all about connecting in crisis. And what do we typically do? When we're in crisis, we introvert. Society has almost created this expectation that we don't talk about our stress. We must introvert. We must hide. We must deal with it on our own until we're strong enough to resume our position in society. And that's not the way we're designed. We're designed to share our experience. And by doing so, we buffer the adverse effects. The fourth thing that athletes do, or the third thing that athletes do exceptionally well, and that is they know how to turn stress off when they don't need it. So when they get on the field, when they get on the court, they capitalize. They want to feel the nerves. They want to feel the butterflies. They want to feel the jitters. That means that they're going to thrive. They're going to excel. They're going to succeed in that environment. They're also going to have tremendous cardiovascular protection, etc. But what they do is when they get off the court, they know how to shut it down. There's a system of the body that is designed specifically to shut down the stress axes. And the biggest issue in society now is that stress in the short term, unbelievable, it's energizing. But we don't know how to turn it off. So we get stressed. We're going to have 5 stresses a week, at least, according to a Yale study. But it's our ability to shut it off when we don't need it that determines whether stress is going to be bad for us or good for us. And athletes access a certain system of the body. It's called the vagus nerve system. We can access it in so many different ways: massage, acupuncture, meditation, reflexology, EFT tapping. There's a whole variety. I give 6 of my personal picks on vagal stimulation in the book. But there's a way to just turn it off at will, and athletes do that well. And then the last thing, I think everyone can identify with this, is it's not during the stress that we feel at our lowest. You know, we're getting through crisis, we're managing every day, we feel emotionally very vulnerable, and we feel a lack of self-worth, and we feel all of these experiences. But our real challenge comes when the stress has passed. And that's when we start getting sick, and that's when we feel emotional instabilities, and that's when we feel psychologically strained. And the most interesting thing is that if we create a molecular bias. So what happens when we get stressed is that certain molecules in the brain get shut down, certain molecules that fortify our physical health get shut down, certain molecules that fortify our emotional well-being get shut down. And the most incredible thing is we can turn those all on. And what I liked in the book, the fourth part of the book, is basically the rebuilding process. So once the stress has passed, you've got to get the body under construction, so to speak, and create a molecular bias. Do activities that elevate serotonin, do activities that elevate brain-derived neurotrophic factor, which I explain in the book. That's the major cognitive powerhouse. Do activities that elevate growth hormone, and that thereby you create this physical, emotional, and cognitive integrity. So that's a strategic model they've used, and I've been able to integrate this in the book quite nicely.
This is a book that has meant a lot to me already in the process of reading it, and it's definitely going to be on my bedside table, and I'm going to refer to it a lot. Thank you again so much for coming in.
Thank you for having me.
And just to recap, my guest is Richard Sutton, and the book is The Stress Code, From Surviving to Thriving. And thank you for watching, and I'll see you again soon.